So we are looking at Sefer HaGadah on page 38, and then we got to the story of Yaakov, Yosef, and the brothers, which is, we're now almost Erev Kippur, and it's appropriate because this is one of the stories, when you go throughout the story of Yosef, and what the brothers did to him, it's really a story of sin, and transgression, and repentance, and apology, that was said, was not said. There are many questions that linger over this, over the story of Yosef and his brothers. The main question, I think, really, if you read through the whole story, is whether Yaakov was ever told by his children what went on. Did he just suspect what happened? Did they ever spoke to him? Was there ever an official apology from the brothers to Yosef, etc.? But this is a this is one thing that we'll have to go through as we go through the story. So the Torah starts the story with Vayeshev Yaakov Beretz Megurei Aviv Beretz Kenaan. Yaakov dwelled in the land of his father in Kenaan, and said, "These are the descendants of Yosef." As if to say that for Yaakov, no one else counted but Yosef. Yosef was the most important person. בן 17 שנה היה רועה את אחיו בצון, והוא נער את בני בלהה ואת בני בזלפה, נשי אביו, ויבא יוסף את דיבתם רעה אל אביהם. So, Yosef was with his brothers as a shepherd, and as they say, the נער is still a young kid, with the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah. So we read that the children of Yaakov are broken into classes. The children of Bilhah and Zilpah are called Bnei HaShefachot, the children of the maidservants, even though they were supposed to be at the same level of all of his children, but they were like second class. And Yosef is with them. So he's maybe because he's young, but maybe because he's pushed aside, because Reuven is the firstborn, so naturally they push the son of Rachel aside. So Yosef, it says, "Vayavei Yosef et dibatam ra'a el avihem." Rashi says, "Kol ma she'ya yachol ledaber b'hem ra'a haya mesaper." Whatever he could say against them, he would say. So we don't know if it was deliberate. So deliberately he sought to say things that were not correct, or just as a young kid, as a teenager, he speaks his mind and doesn't think that he could offend someone. The interesting thing here is that after we read that Yaakov loved Yosef more than everyone else, and the brothers, ויראו אחיו כי אותו אהב אביהם מכל אחיו, וישנאו אותו ולא יכלו לדברו לשלום, they developed such hatred towards him that they couldn't even say hello to him. Lo yachalu daberu leshalom. I mean, unless they had to tell him something technical, they would not engage in conversation with them. So this is a common thing. We know that this could happen. But what is really amazing is that Yosef couldn't read that, because he keeps going to them and says, "Listen to this dream," and then this dream conveys the message that I'm going to be your master. And they get even angrier. And he comes with another dream. And he says, "Wait, don't you get it that they don't like you? Why are you doing that?" So that's part of a problem, maybe because of his young age, because later on he develops a very keen understanding of how to deal with people. But it seems like at this young age, and it happens to teenagers, by the way, that it's hard for them to read social cues, body language, the behavior of other people around them. They're immersed in the own world. And this is maybe what Midrash is saying here. It says, "V'yosef ben 17 shana v'hu na'al, sh'haya oseh ma'aseh na'arut, memashmesh b'ainav, metaleh ba'akevo, metaken b'is'aro." So the Midrash interprets that as Yosef taking care of his appearance. He spends time on combing his hair, getting his hairdo, his eyes. Maybe back then, men also used to put makeup. So he wants to look handsome. Metaleba akivo, he walks in a way, maybe in an arrogant way. But well, the Midrash speaks only about the external appearance, and they get Yosef for that several times. They say that that was also the reason that Potiphar's wife went after him, because Yosef was had this natural beauty, to the extent, by the way, that in Arabic, because they follow the stories of the Quran that they took from the Bible, and a synonym for beauty is Yusufuhu. Like, he is, to be Yosef is to be beautiful, to be handsome. But I think beyond that, it's not just about the his appearances, it's the question of self-absorption. He's completely absorbed in himself. So he could go to his brothers and say, I'm going to be your king, you know? And they say, we can't talk to you. So he doesn't care. He'll come tomorrow and tell them another dream. And not only that, when his father says, let me send you to them to see how they're doing, he doesn't say, I don't think that I should be with them in the same, you know, in a remote place. It might be dangerous. Yeah, why not? He's going there. So this is, by the way, the first wake-up call of Yosef when they throw him into the pit. Because Yosef will be betrayed three times. And only after the third time, it's the sort of the final wake-up call. The first time he's betrayed is by his brothers. He could not imagine that he's going to be thrown into the pit. They throw him into the pit, they walk away, and he knows that he's going to die. And they don't care. Yes, they came back later, but it was too late. And only many, many years later, they say, "Aval Hashemim anachnu alahinu, Hashereinu tzarat nafsho b'tchananu elonu v'lo shamanu." It's our fault. They felt that everything that happened to them is a punishment for not paying attention to Yosef when he was in the pit. But for him, even if it took only a couple of minutes, 10 or 15 minutes, until the Ishmaelim, the merchants came and pulled him out, in those 10, 15 minutes, his whole world is upside down. He didn't know that his brothers could go to that distance and to be willing to kill him. So that's the first wake-up call where he realizes you cannot trust everyone around you. You have to be more careful. The second time around, when he trusted even brothers, right? Be careful. Second time around, when he trusted people, was Eshet Potiphar, because she makes advances on him, and he says, "No, I cannot do that. I'm loyal to my master," and he thinks that will be the end of it. That he showed his honesty and she respects it, but no, she made the advance on him. He ran away, and then she blamed him that he assaulted her, that he is the attacker, and was thrown to jail. So second wake-up call. Don't trust even the people that you work with. Then, in jail, he sits with the Sarah Mashkim, Sarah Ofim, the cupbearer and the royal baker, and when he trusts them, he realizes that it doesn't really work. Velo zachar Sarah Mashkim et Yosef, the cupbearer forgot Yosef for 2 years until he had to recall him and bring him out of jail. So Yosef, it took him time to realize that you really have to put your trust solely in God and in yourself, and work your way around people. This is the lesson that Yosef learned. That's why later on throughout the story, you see that Yosef manipulates everyone to get his thing done. But in this early stage, he's self-absorbed and he doesn't read the what happens around him. Then Midrash goes on to say, "V'Yisrael ahav et Yosef mikol echav, mikol banav." Israel loved Yosef more than all of his children. Shehaya ziv ikonin shelo domelo. Here we see an interesting element in the Midrash that, well, the people have to be careful. I mentioned several times not to take Midrash literally, because the Midrash is directed to people at a certain age, and the Midrash would, the rabbis of the Midrash would use certain techniques that are appropriate for their time and cannot be understood out of their time. And here what they did is this. The Torah says, why did Yaakov love Yosef more than all of his children? Ki ben zekunim hulo. He is the children of zekunim. Zekunim comes from the Hebrew word zaken, old age. So ben zekunim means someone who was born at the father's old age. So, or the youngest of all the children, meaning that he will be there when the father sort of like he will be the support for the father when the father becomes old, because he's the youngest and the strongest. So for Yaakov, Yosef was this support, because he was the only son of Rachel that Rachel was always also able to raise, because the second son of Rachel, Benjamin, Rachel died when she gave birth to him. So from Yosef it's Ben Zekunim. This is what the pasuk says. The rabbis say Ben Zekunim. They took the word Zekunim and they broke it into two words: Ziv, which means glow, or in this case, the sort of the light shines from one's face, the expression. Ziv ikonin. Ikonin is a Greek word that we use today, icon, on when we speak about computer icons or on the phone. But ikonin means literally face. It's also found in the English word iconoclastic. Iconoclastic in English means someone who breaks idols. And originally meant literally people. It was a Christian sect who didn't approve of all the statues in the churches. So they would go to churches and break idols. It was in the 5th, 6th century. Then they disappeared, and we use the term iconoclast when we speak about someone who breaks the norms and goes against the conventional wisdom. So that's an iconoclast. But the word icon in itself means image. So they say the expression and his image was like that of Rachel. Ben zekunim lo shaya ziv ikonin shelo domelo o domele Rachel. But interesting thing, what the Midrash did, it explained a biblical word by using a Greek word. So obviously, it could not have been in the intention of the Torah to convey a message in Greek 1500 years before the language was even known to the Israelites, to Bnei Israel. Anyway, ve'asalo ketonet pasim. So what is this famous ketonet pasim? Literally means striped robe. In the musical, it became the technicolor robe. In Hebrew, they call it Yosef Viktonet HaPasim HaMeshagat. But the Midrash says, Pasim Shaita Magat Ad Pas Yado. That it got all the way to his wrist. Devar Acher Shaita Daka V'Kala B'Yoter V'Nitmenet B'Fas Yad. It was so light, the fabric was so delicate, that you could fold it and hold it in your hand. Like the raincoat of today. The rabbis had this in Mishnaic times. There was a fascination with light fabric because of especially when you think about the summer in Israel, you need light garment. The Mishnah actually says about Rabbi Eliezer ben Harsom, who was very, very wealthy and also was a Kohen, that his mother made for him a robe. When he was the Kohen Gadol on Yom Kippur, the high priest had the option of either wearing the regular garments, what's called Bigdei Lavan, the white garments that he would do when he goes into Kodesh HaKodeshim, the inner sanctuary, or to get his own. So there was a competition between the Kohanim to buy fancier garments. So they say that they would do a garment that was worth 800 money, like 800 zuz, 800 golden coins, or 1200. And then they said that that Rabbi Elazar ben Harsom, his mother made him a robe that was worth 10,000 golden coins, meaning 10 times more expensive than the most expensive robes that other people did. But lo inihua hava kohanim lelovsha mipnei she'a nira besoro mitocha. It was so fine that the fabric was so delicate that they could see his flesh through it. So they didn't. The Kohanim said, "This is inappropriate. You cannot wear it. It's too fine." But they had this at the time of the Mishnah. The garment industry in the Middle East was very advanced, and they really appreciated something light. So they said, "Ketonet pasim," that you could fold it and put it in your hand. Rashi says something else. It's also from the Midrash. Which is a very interesting comment. It says, "Le'olam lo yeshane adam beno ben abanim shebishvil mishkal shnei sela'im melat shosif Yosef shosif Yaakov libno התגלגלו כל הדברים האלה. So they say, Rashi brings this midrash that teaches us a message, an educational message derived from the psukim. Never give one of your children preferential treatment. See, how much was it worth, the special robe that Yaakov made for his son? How much more was it worth than the rest of the garments that he gave his other children? They say, Mishkal shnei sena'im elat. So two coins, two, three coins, extra ornament or something that he added to the kutonet. But that became the kutonet, this robe became the symbol of the animosity of the brothers towards Yosef. Because what do they say? What do they do when they throw him into the pit? Vayafshitu et kutonto. They take away his robe. Why do they have to do that? Why can't they throw him with the robe into the pit? To throw him there naked? Yes, part of it was that they figured out that he might get out and run away, but without the robe, he's like an animal. He has no identification marks. Everybody can claim him because you live in the desert. There are different tribes. Your garments mark you. You know which tribe you belong to, Midianite, Ishmaelite, whatever. But the other thing was that this was really the symbol of their hatred. This is why they hated him. Here is the favorite child. They in their face, every day they see, this is the favorite child. And when they want to inform Yaakov or deceive Yaakov and tell him that Yosef died, they don't say it outright. They take the garment, the robe, they dip it in blood, and they send it to Yaakov. So the ketonet became the symbol. She says, it's not worth it. If you want to give, if you give preferential treatment to one of your children, you end up causing troubles. And the truth is that even when you try to treat everyone equally, there will always be someone who will feel that they're less than the other, and you have to work hard to tell them, no, I love you all equally. So we should not exacerbate that by really doing it outright. And just one more comment on that issue of the way the robe of Yosef was sent to Yaakov. This goes in line with the consequences of Yaakov's deception of his father, because he deceived his father with false garments and goats, and now he's being deceived by a garment of his own son and a goat which was slaughtered in order to dip the garment in blood. So this is the concept of teshuvah and repentance, that when you don't repent, it comes back to haunt you. We'll stop here. Baruch Adonai.